Today's video topic is GraphQL. Among the videos on API-related topics, linked in the fixed comment, we learned about RESTful API, which is the most widely used today, in this video. If you still don't know about RESTful API, I recommend watching the RESTful API video first. The GraphQL we are going to discuss today is also one of the many ways in which clients and servers communicate. It doesn't hold as large a share as the RESTful API, but thanks to its distinct advantages, it is being used effectively in many places. Let's revisit the example of the book management system that we used in the RESTful API video and see how GraphQL differs from RESTful API and what its pros and cons are. In the case of RESTful API, the HTTP method used for transmission and the URI was used to distinguish each operation. This method has the advantage of being able to intuitively understand the content of the request, but the disadvantage is that you have to manage many endpoints. GraphQL, like SOAP, uses a single endpoint and usually delivers all requests using the POST method. Doing so makes API version management easier. The important part starts now. We're going to look at a request to get a list of books. Although a RESTful API can clearly indicate where which book's data request is, it cannot be specific about which items will be obtained from each. If a client app wants to show a screen where the list of books appears with brief information, only the title and author of each book need to be fetched from the server, but a RESTful API conventionally returns all data from each resource. As a result, there is an overfetching problem where unnecessary data is being transmitted. These kinds of requests and responses are continuously exchanged in the various services we use, so there could be significant data waste and overhead in the process. Now let's look at how the same task is handled in GraphQL. In GraphQL, such a request is sent via the POST method. This is what's called a query message written here. It is requesting the titles and author information of the books like this. In response, such data is returned. As you can see, only the data requested by the query is included and nothing else. In other words, GraphQL allows the client to pick and choose only the information they need from the server. Another problem with RESTful API that can be solved by GraphQL is underfetching.
So now it's a problem of getting too little data?
Yes, the problem specifically is having to send multiple requests. For example, let's say there are detailed views of each book where the reader's review is shown with their nickname. To display this, the information of the book, the reviews on the book, and the information of the user who posted the review are needed. In a RESTful API, you have to get these from different requests. First, you get the book's information by sending a request with the book's index number. Then, you get the reviews of the book based on the same index number. After that, you must request and receive the user's information who wrote each review, the same number of times as the number of indexes. So, this problem of having to send many requests just to display one screen, in other words, the underfetching problem where a single request does not get enough data, arises. Simultaneously, the overfetching problem also occurs where more data than necessary is fetched in each request.
Sticking to REST principles too dogmatically can be not so good for performance in some cases.
That's right. But with GraphQL, you can proceed like this. In this query, the information needed for the application screen are hierarchically represented like this. We'll send the title and author of the book with the index number 1, and the reviews of the book. Each review contains comments, ratings, and the information of the user who wrote it. In the user information, it asks to include only the name. In response, this data is returned. With a single request, you can get all the necessary information.
Isn't that great?
Now, let's look at how to add a book. For data inquiry, query was used. Meanwhile, for adding, modifying, and deleting data, mutation is used. Add the data to add in an operation named addBook. And if you specify the data you want to receive in response like this, the result is returned like this. Another element of GraphQL is subscription. Suppose that you need to detect and display new reviews in real time on the book information screen. With a RESTful API, you would need to constantly send requests to the server to get a list of reviews. But with GraphQL, you can receive notifications whenever data is updated on a certain resource. That is, you're applying for a subscription for the resource. If a review about a book with an index number of 1 is added, it asks for this information about the review. When someone adds a review, this data is immediately sent. The front end reacts to this, showing an updated screen with the returned result. This process is accomplished using WebSockets, which we will cover later.
This GraphQL thing looks pretty great, but I think it might be a bit difficult to implement. With REST API, all you have to do is code what the server is going to do for each HTTP method and URI, but I don't even have a clue how to write code with this GraphQL.
Yes, it can feel tough for those who haven't used it before. But remember, as its name suggests, GraphQL is a language for making queries, just like SQL. There are libraries that perform server or client operations through messages written in this language. On the official GraphQL website, you can check out GraphQL libraries available for different languages and environments. Their usage can be found on their respective websites as documents or guides. So, let's look at the schema, a common aspect, in this video. The schema is a blueprint that defines what kind of data can be used and what requests and subscriptions can be delivered and executed in a service using GraphQL. Just like resources used in the service are each defined as a type, each type specifies what kind of data can be included, and you simply specify which you want to retrieve in your request message. What kind of queries, mutations, subscriptions can be implemented using these types are defined like this on the right. Of course, these are merely declarations of each operation. You would write the code that implements this depending on the language and environment you use and the GraphQL library you use. This is an example of code written using the Apollo library in the Node.js environment.
Based on what I've seen so far, GraphQL seems to have only advantages over the REST API. But the fact that REST API is still more widely used implies there must be some disadvantages too, right?
Yes. Let's look at the disadvantages of GraphQL and when it may be a good fit, considering these points for the last time. The first difficulty is caching, the same problem as SOAP we discussed in the last video. Because requests are composed of complex GraphQL messages, caching based on these is not easy. The second is a performance issue. It can stress on the server due to interpreting complex queries and executing operations compared to the REST API. Lastly, the learning curve. The fact that it feels harder to learn compared to the REST API acts as a barrier.
That seems like a short list compared to the advantages, but each point seems substantial.
Yes, therefore, the cases where GraphQL can be more appropriate than REST API can be as follows. Firstly, services with complex and vast data models. For services where overhead due to overfetching and underfetching is large, using GraphQL would be advantageous in terms of performance. Similarly, services where clients have a lot of control over data requests can fully utilize the strengths of GraphQL. Lastly, services requiring real-time reactions to data updates. Using GraphQL subscriptions, you can represent the latest information in real-time without having to implement a separate function. You just need to choose the best method for your service considering these points. That's all we have for the overview of GraphQL. For the next topic, let's discuss gRPC. See you in the next video then.